The no escape zone for an air-to-air missile, it is not what many think it is. I mentioned this concept in the previous video about the meteor missile, so it's definitely worth discussing this again. Welcome to Millennium 7 Star, the channel that helps you make sense of military history and military technology. This video is a follow-up of the previous video about the meteor missile. In that video, I talk about the no escape zone for an air-to-air missile. The no escape zone for an air-to-air missile is not what many people think it is. It is not the volume of space in which the missile is guaranteed to hit the target. There's no such thing. The no escape zone is the volume of space in which the missile can catch up with the target if the target runs away. So it is not a fixed number. Its size depends from the energy that is imparted to the weapon by the launcher, so height and speed of the launcher. It obviously depends from the engine burn, and it depends from the kinematic capabilities of the target. Fast target can run away more efficiently than a slow target. The no escape zone varies continuously with the maneuvers that the launcher and the target are doing. They can both change direction, speed up, slow down, and the no escape zone varies accordingly. This doesn't mean that the missile will hit the target, because within that distance the target can do maneuvers to defeat dynamically the missile, and also there could be electronic countermeasures or any other form of defensive maneuvers and defensive activities. So the no escape zone is not a number, and the numbers that you see around are either estimates or just marketing from the vendor. The true numbers are secret, and they are among the most closely guarded secrets about these weapons. Now, the meteor specification required a no escape zone to be at least double than that of the AMRAAM. It is necessary to point out that those specifications were based on the B version of the AMRAAM. Another element that was discussed is the superiority of the meteor in terms of kinematic performances if compared with the AMRAAM. Well, we don't have, as usual, the exact numbers because they're secret, but the double impulse engine of the AMRAAM doesn't work as well as the meteor propulsion system. In the AMRAAM, the double impulse is obtained by varying the size of the grain of the propellant in the solid rocket booster. Larger grains of propellant tend to burn slower and for a longer time. And this is what generates the sustained thrust. Within the AMRAAM booster, there are two different grains. The faster burning grains burn first and accelerate the weapon. The slow burning grains burn last. But still, it is a single burn and it's not throttable. The Meteor propulsion system is throttable, and that's the key point. The Meteor can regulate its thrust in the same way a plane does. So in conjunction with the data link, it can really fly every kind of smart trajectories as long as the engine is actually working. So as you can see, it's not a matter of preferring one or the other, it's just different technology choices with different results. This doesn't mean that the AMRAAM version D is an ineffective weapon. So, thank you very much for watching, and goodbye.